Chemistry in Its Element podcast. Curious tales of chemical compounds.
This week, Brian Clegg brings us a plastic precursor that doubles as a very tricky spelling test.
Plastics are having a bad press, so much so that it can be easy to forget the benefits they provide in, for example, keeping food hygienic. It's in this context that we should take a look at terephthalic acid, a relatively simple organic acid with a pair of CO2H additions to a benzene ring. That clumsy-looking name with the pH-TH in the middle is a combination of two components. There's terebic, meaning derived from turpentine, after terebinth, the name of the tree in the cashew family that was one of the first sources of the painter's solvent. And then there's phthalic, a contraction of naphthalic from the petroleum-derived hydrogen mix. The substance itself dates back to 1846, when French chemist Amédée Caillot first produced it from turpentine, a blend of organic compounds derived from distilled tree resin. The acid proved to be one of those interesting but ultimately useless discoveries until the 1950s, when it became an essential precursor to one of the most widely used thermoplastics, the polyester polyethylene terephthalate, or PET. The range of uses of this material is quite remarkable. It's common in food and drink packaging, in plastic bottles, of which 488 billion were produced in 2016, food containers, and more. It was an early entrant in the plastic-based textile industry under the trade name Terraline. It is stretched out into an often metallized film with the trade name Mylar and has plenty more niche applications, from 3D printing to providing the substrate to support thin film solar cells. That takes many millions of tons of terephthalic acid, which were never going to be supplied from turpentine. However, a better method was discovered back in 1862. We read in the Proceedings of the Royal Society, "We noticed among the products of the action of nitric acid on certain liquid hydrocarbons contained in Rangoon tar, an acid of peculiar properties." Monsieur Caillot's account of his new acid was so brief and incomplete that although we recognise many points of resemblance between it and the acid we had obtained from Burmese naphtha, we were compelled to repeat his experiments on oil of turpentine before we could fix with certainty the identity of the two products. The acid is now synthesised by an updated process of catalyzed oxidation of 1,4-xylene, or p-xylene, a benzene ring with a pair of opposing methyl groups attached. This is produced from naphtha, effectively as a byproduct of the catalytic process converting naphtha into one of the main components of petrol. The white crystalline acid has other uses, ending up in paints, polyester resins, and as raw material in pharmaceuticals. Its most bizarre application is in military smoke grenades, used to obscure vision with a thick white smoke. However, no other use can come close to its starring role in the production of plastics. Alongside PET, terephthalic acid is also a precursor for polybutene terephthalate, or PBT. This is less versatile, but still turns up in a diverse range of products, from electrical insulators to showerheads and swimwear, as it has a better chlorine resistance than many fibres. PBT also turns up in the bathroom, in toothbrush bristles and false eyelashes. Plastics such as PET will continue to be important in our lives, which means more terephthalic acid being produced. For example, China's production capacity of the acid has been forecast to rise from around 43 million tonnes per annum in 2017 to 53 million in 2022. But as we move away from fossil fuels, petroleum will be an increasingly undesirable raw material. Unlike the other main input for PET production, monoethylene glycol, terephthalic acid can't yet be commercially produced from a renewable source. the potential environmental benefits of change are clear. In 2018, Ramani Narayan, professor of chemical engineering and material sciences at Michigan State University, commented, "If just 20% of the carbon in the 37.5 million or so metric tons of PET used in making bottles worldwide were to be replaced with bio-based carbon, that would absorb 17.2 million metric tons of CO2 from the environment. That would be the equivalent to about 40 million barrels of oil savings." Having a greener source for terephthalic acid would require it to be produced from biomass, plant matter, which reduces greenhouse gases by deriving the carbon for the compound from carbon dioxide in the air and reduces emissions during production. Experimental sources currently include corn and sugar beet, in both cases rooting via xylene, or orange peel, which is as yet less of an industrial process, but is interesting both involving a waste product as a source and in rooting directly to terephthalic acid from a derivative of limonene, an oily compound of citrus fruit skins. It's good that we are concerned with the environmental impact of the misuse of plastics, but just as we shouldn't throw away the drink bottle into the ocean, we shouldn't throw away the hygiene and practicality benefits that a versatile and recyclable plastic such as PET has brought us. And all thanks to that seemingly useless discovery in turpentine.
Brian Clegg with terephthalic acid. Next week, Mike Fremantle marks the 20th anniversary of a huge environmental disaster.
Hungarian authorities estimated that 1,240 tons of dead fish washed up along the river. The poisoning of the Tisza was considered by some observers to be the worst environmental disaster in Europe since the Chernobyl nuclear accident in April 1996.
Until then, email chemistryworld at rsc.org or tweet at chemistryworld with any ideas for compounds that we should cover, and you'll find all of our previous podcasts at chemistryworld.com/podcasts. I'm Ben Valsler. Thank you for joining me.